Okay, welcome back to the Go Draft, elevating your screenwriting to the next level. My name is Andy Guerdat. I've been a working writer in Hollywood for 45 years. I've also taught screen and television writing at UCLA and Pepperdine for 20-something years on and off. So you have an idea for a movie, what's the next step? The first thing you want to do is to define that thing that got you excited, that thing that made the idea come to you in the first place. And I call it the moment, U-R. The reason I call it that is because was considered to be, by archaeologists, for a long time anyway, to be the original civilization, the original city. It was in ancient Mesopotamia. And because of that, the U-R hyphen became the prefix that means the progenitor of something. For example, a lot of people would say that Edgar Allan Poe's Murders in the Rue Morgue is the detective story. It was the original detective story. Sherlock Holmes all the way to CSI has been based in some way on that detective story. So this is your original thought, your original spark. It's a spark, it's a sperm, it's germs, it's a genesis. It's an indivisible moment, the thing which cannot be divided and reduced any farther. It's yours and it's original. It could be a scene, it could be a character, it could be a line of dialogue, it could be just a feeling. But whatever it is that got you inspired, it's as if the hand of God reached down and touched Adam's finger with the spark of life, like this. If that's a little too biblical for you, then maybe it feels more like this. Okay, so your ape just touched your monolith. Now what? My advice is this. That moment that you just felt, remember it. Do not write it down. And for God's sakes, don't share it with anybody. It's yours. It's precious. It's secret. Think of it like a candle, like a flickering flame of a candle. And you got to keep your hands cupped around it to keep it alive. You want to keep that thing alive, that feeling alive, through the entire run of the process of writing it and, God willing, shooting it all the way to the audience. And there's a reason for this. And it's because if that's what excites you, that's probably going to be your best shot at what will excite an audience. I'll give you an example. I remember I talked about the screenplay I wrote when I was just starting out. And this was the moment for me. I don't know why. Couldn't tell you to this day. I just thought it would be cool. I had an image of this upscale couple, man and a woman, married couple, well-dressed, good-looking, beautiful home. He's in a suit and tie. He's getting ready to go to work, kisses his wife goodbye, walks out the front door, and as it closes, there's a voiceover of a police detective saying, "When was the last time you saw your husband, Mrs. McLaughlin?" And I just thought that would be cool. I don't know why. That would make me interested. I would want to know what happened. Why would a guy who seems to have a perfect life suddenly disappear without any explanation? And from that, I developed a detective story. That particular screenplay was optioned, re-optioned, bought, sold. I rewrote it for Richard Dreyfuss to star in. I rewrote it for a director named Richard Franklin to direct. I rewrote it for a director named Peter Hyams to direct. I rewrote it for a producer named Herb Jaffe. And eventually it got made many years later. In all those drafts that I wrote, the one thing that never changed was what I just told you, that opening sequence which had excited me. That got through all the notes and all the executives and all the noise that goes into getting a screenplay made over years, and it excited other people enough that so that I don't even think I ever got a suggestion to change it. It was always there, and it was there in the finished product. There are other errors that are also much more famous than that one, like this.
Here, hold this.
So I was there at in May of 1977 at Grauman's Chinese Theater, standing in line like everybody else to see this movie that everybody heard about, but nobody knew anything about, other than it was some sort of science fiction thing called Star Wars. And that audience that saw it with me, we were like tabula rasa. We had no preconceptions. We had no idea what we were about to see. And when the scene I just showed you played, the audience made the weirdest sound. It was sort of a laugh and sort of a gasp, and it, as if they sucked the air out of the theater with pure delight. It was the sound of pure delight. Lucas said at the time that all he was trying to do with Star Wars was to create a movie that was like a kid's adventure story, the Disney kid's adventure stories that he grew up watching, as did I. Like Swiss Family Robinson and In Search of the Castaways, those kind of movies. He wanted that feeling. And he got it. He nailed it. As baseball players say, he squared it up. When the round bat hits the round ball exactly right, and you square it up and it flies over the fence. He nailed it. And he hit it again with Empire Strikes Back. By the time you got to Return of the Jedi, you're starting to feel it getting lost a bit. And by the time they got around to the second trilogy, he lost it. And it was suddenly about the politics of a non-existent fantasy universe, galaxy, and some warmed over Zen philosophizing. He lost it. And then after those three, he turned over the creative reins to J.J. Abrams and Rian Johnson, and they did their best to infuse it back with that sense that they had felt as well from the original Star Wars. He had it and he lost it. Alan Ball was a screenwriter having a tough time in life. I'm not sure where he was, probably in New York, I think. Going through a difficult time, he's sitting on the city street on a bench or something, just staring out at the world, and he sees one of those plastic grocery bags bobbing along in the wind in the middle of the city street, people walking by, not paying any attention to it except for him. And out of that came this moment.
You want to see the most beautiful thing I've ever filmed? Days where it's a minute away from snowing, and there's this electricity in the air. You can almost hear it, right? And this bag was just dancing with me. Like a little kid begging me to play with it. For 15 minutes. That's the day I realized that there was this entire life behind things. And this incredibly benevolent force that wanted me to know that there was no reason to be afraid. Never. Video's a poor excuse, I know. But it helps me remember. I need to remember. Sometimes there's so much beauty in the world. I feel like I can't take it. And my heart is just going to cave in.
Okay, did you feel it? Do you feel his excitement? That draft that he wrote based on that moment inspired him to structure out a movie called American Beauty. And that scene made it through every draft, every cut, all the way to the end. It's what made him excited, and it's at least in part what made the audience excited. The scene never changed. The Coen brothers were sitting around trying to think of what their next movie was going to be, and one of them said, you know, I have this image in my head, a man's fedora, you know, like an old-fashioned 1940s slick-looking city fedora, and it's blowing in the woods. Why? How did it get there? Who did it belong to? And out of that came this. Answer to how did the hat get in the woods is one of the really, really powerful scenes that they've ever shot. But that's what inspired them. That's what got them started. That was their moment. How much power can that moment have? That excitement of the original writer? It has potentially, depending on the execution, depending on the craft of the people who are making the film, that moment can transcend centuries, like this. People watch a clip like that and they say, well, that's not the writing, that's the director, it's the cinematographer, it's the actors, it's the composer. That's who's inspired, that's not the writer. yes, it's true, the director and the cinematographer and the actors and the composers and everybody else involved, editors, everyone involved, production designers, everyone involved in the creative expression required to get a movie made, yes, they were all jazzed. They were all jazzed by a 450-year-old screenplay written by a guy named Bill Shakespeare. That's what got them jazzed. That's what got their best work out of them. That's what made it work. Or how about the power in this clip?
How much time we got?
Yesterday, for further consultations with his government, he returned to the Vienna. This is Ed Fletcher in Vienna.
Take two, Q Howard.
I don't have to tell you things are bad. Everybody knows things are bad. It's a depression. Everybody's out of work or scared of losing their job. The dollar buys a nickel's worth. Banks are going bust. Shopkeepers keep a gun under the counter. Punks are running wild in the street, and there's nobody anywhere who seems to know what to do, and there's no end to it. We know the air is unfit to breathe and our food is unfit to eat. We sit watching our TVs while some local newscaster tells us that today we had 15 homicides and 63 violent crimes, as if that's the way it's supposed to be. We know things are bad, worse than bad. They're crazy. It's like everything everywhere is going crazy, so we don't go out anymore. We sit in the house, and slowly the world we're living in is getting smaller, and all we say is, please, at least leave us alone in our living rooms. Let me have my toaster and my TV and my steel-belted radios, and I won't say anything. Just leave us alone. Well, I'm not going to leave you alone. I want you to get mad. I don't want you to protest. I don't want you to riot. I don't want you to write to your congressmen because I wouldn't know what to tell you to write. I don't know what to do about the depression and the inflation and the Russians and the crime in the street. All I know is that first, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm a human being. God damn it. My life has value. So, I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. I want you to get up right now and go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore! I want you to get up right now. Get up, go to your windows, open them, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore! Things have got to change.
How many stations does this go out?
You've got to get mad!
67. I know it goes to Louisville and Atlanta.
We're not going to take this anymore! Then we'll figure out what to do about the depression and the inflation and the oil crisis. But first, get up out of your chairs, open the window, stick your head out and yell, and say, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
Who are you talking to, Herb?
CGG Atlanta.
Are they yelling in Atlanta, Herb?
Are they yelling in Atlanta, Ted?
But first, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
They're yelling in Baton Rouge.
God damn it. Get up, get up, get up out of your
chair. Son of a bitch! We struck the mother lobe!
Stick your head out of the window, open it, and stick your head out and keep yelling and yell, I'm as mad as hell, I'm not going to take this anymore. Just get up from your chairs right now. Go to
where
the
window. Where
are you
going? I want to see if anybody's yelling.
Window, open it and stick your head out and yell and keep yelling. I'm
mad as hell. How am I going to take this anymore?
I'm mad as hell. I'm not going to take it anymore.
I'm mad as hell. I'm not going to take it anymore.
I'm mad as hell. I'm not going to take it anymore.
I'm not going to take it anymore.
Now, what you just saw, that clip from Network from 1976, was not only one of the best screenplays ever written, it's one of the most important things written in the 20th century, because with it, Paddy Chayefsky, the writer, anticipated reality television, which did not exist in 1976. He anticipated the Arab oil embargo. He anticipated the Tea Party movement. He anticipated Trumpism. I mean, if what you just saw, that speech, you could say it at a MAGA rally now. I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore. It's a brilliant piece of work. How do you think the director, Sidney Lumet, felt when he read that script? when he read that scene, and there's lots of other great scenes in that script, but he specifically that scene, what do you think he felt? What do you think he thought? I'm going to pretty much guarantee you he thought, I'm going to look so great when I shoot this. I can already see how I want to shoot it. I'm going to do a slow push in on Peter Finch as he starts the speech. I'm going to hard cut to the lightning flashes. I'm going to backlight everybody so you can't see their faces as they're screaming out the windows. I'm going to look terrific. How do you think Peter Finch, the actor, felt when he read that scene? He thought, I'm going to win an Oscar for this. And he did. He won it posthumously, actually, because he died soon after the filming and before the Oscars. Faye Dunaway, the actress in it, thought, I'm sure, oh my God, I'm going to win an Oscar. And she did. The point being, that scene, that script, that moment got to everybody, got them jazzed, got them excited. So they said, I want to be in this movie. Tell me how to do it. Please, let me do this movie. Now, before we go any farther, this moment doesn't have to be as profound or as important as a lot of the things I've shown you. It can also just be comic. It can be the desire to be ridiculously silly, like this.
As chairwoman of the reception committee, I extend the good wishes of every man, woman, and child of Fredonia.
Never mind that stuff. Take a card.
Card? What'll I do with the card?
You can keep it. I've got 51 left. Now, what were you saying?
As chairwoman of the reception committee, I welcome you with open arms.
Is that so? How late do you stay open?
I've sponsored your appointment because I feel you are the most able statesman in all Fredonia.
Well, that covers a lot of ground. Say, you cover a lot of ground yourself. You better beat it. I hear they're going to tear you down and put up an office building where you're standing. You can leave in a taxi. If you can't get a taxi, you can leave in a huff. If that's too soon, you can leave in a minute and a half.
Or like this.
Stryker, you're coming in too fast.
I know.
He knows.
It was below 700 now, still going down. 675, 650, 625. He's holding me. He's down.
Sound your alarm bell, now.
All right, now, everybody, get in crash position.
Now, from the sublime to the slightly less than sublime, this same process, this same principle works in television or in any other creative endeavor that you need to write a script for. The same principle applies. Find something to get excited about that gets you excited and then try to get that on the screen. Here's an example from just a few years ago, a couple years ago. The last 20 years, I've written a lot of children's animation. I'm a working writer. This is what people were paying for, and this is what I was writing. And I was happy to do it. And I wound up on a show, as a staff writer on a show called Fancy Nancy for Disney Channel. It was obviously for little girls primarily. And I'm happy to do it. Did some really good work there. At one point, the toy division of Disney came to the producers and said, gee, we think we can sell a toy vanity, a Fancy Nancy vanity for little girls. If you could come up with some kind of a story that featured a vanity, gosh, we'd really appreciate it. Well, the assignment got dumped on my desk. And I did what I just described to you. I tried to think of something about a vanity that would be exciting to me. And I thought, gosh, I remember when I was 5, 6, 7, as the main character is in this particular series, when I was that age, I can remember going to my grandparents' house and seeing this cool old furniture. In my case, it was like an old roll-top desk, you know, and it had little pigeonholes and drawers, and you'd open them up, and oh, look at this cool old stuff in there. I remembered that feeling. And I also remembered seeing my daughter at that age when she was so full of excitement about what life may hold in store for her and all the things she might want to do. And I took that excitement and I, from that, structured a story and I wrote this.
Look in each nook of this vanity, magnifique, there's a discovery inside. Each thing I find sparks a dream that is fantastique, sending me off on a whimsical ride. This marvel, this vanity, makes things seem real, like writing a book or a play. It's marvel, this mirroring reflects what I feel, like being all grown up one day.
Or if you want an example from someone who's more of a contemporary of yours, probably. I used to be friendly with Damien Chazelle when he first moved to Hollywood to try to break in as a filmmaker. And he's knocking around. He finally gets some jobs writing sequels to horror movies. But he wanted to make his own film. And so he managed to get the money together to shoot a proof of concept reel for a movie called Whiplash that he wanted to shoot. And what do you think he shot?
3, 5, 6, and. Not quite my tempo. Here we go. 5, 6, and. Downbeat on 18. Okay, here we go. 5, 6, and. Bar 17, the and of 4. Got it? 5, 6, 7. Not quite my tempo. It's all good. No worries. Here we go. 5, 6, 7. You're rushing. Here we go. Ready? Okay. 5, 6, and. Dragging just a hair. Wait for my cue. 5, 6, 7. Rushing. 5, 6, and. Dragging. 5, 6, I suppose I just hurled a chair at your head, Neiman.
I don't know.
Sure you do.
The tempo?
Were you rushing or were you dragging?
I don't know.
Start counting.
5, 6, 7.
In 4, damn it! Look at me!
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Now, was I rushing or was I dragging?
I don't know.
Count again.
1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Rushing or dragging?
Rushing.
So you do know the difference.
So that was the moment, the exciting spark that got Damien Chazelle excited, that got him the money to make the short, that got him the money to make the feature, which got him a career. That was him. You need yours. And what do you need it for? Here's what you're going to use it for. It's a practical thing. In the course of outlining, in the course of writing a script, you're going to be going through so many steps. And there's going to come a point sooner or later where you're just sick of this thing. You're tired. Why am I doing all this work? I'm not getting paid. Why don't I just stop? Other people go into parties. They're going to the beach. They're going to Vegas for the weekend. I know I should stay and work on my script, but gosh, I really don't want to. And that's the point where you pull out that little candle, that little spark, and you blow on it, and you bring it back to life, and it says to you, oh yeah, that's what got me excited. That's why I wanted to do this. That's why I put all this time and energy into this project. It will rekindle your excitement. It has another function. If you should finish it, and if people like it, and if you start getting meetings with agents, managers, producers, actors, directors, whomever, you'll start getting a lot of notes. Everybody's going to have notes, and some of them are good notes. Many of them are lateral notes, notes that don't really make any difference, and a lot of them are terrible notes. You can adjust your story a lot within the confines of those bad notes, but the one thing you can't get rid of is that moment, that spark that made you excited, because if you do, the chances are almost 100%, the audience is never going to be excited either, because if what got you jazzed is gone, what's likely to get them jazzed is gone as well. And the people who are giving you notes very often aren't the brightest bulbs, and you know their notes may be terrible, and they may extinguish that flame. That's where you draw the line. That's the notes you cannot take. I'll give you an example. I'm a bit of a history buff. I was reading a book about World War II, and there was a chapter about the Nazi occupation of the Balkans, which includes the Carpathian Mountains, otherwise known as Transylvania. And when I read that, I had, bang, bang, that little moment, and I thought, here's an idea for a movie. What if there's a Nazi garrison in a castle high in the Carpathian Mountains, and it suddenly stops broadcasting, its radio traffic suddenly goes silent, and an American Signal Corps officer in Egypt or somewhere, whose job it is to monitor it, notices this, and he reports it to his commanding officer, and the commanding officer says, oh my God, this may mean that there's partisan forces who have overtaken this garrison. We need to send a commando force in there to see what's going on, and if possible, to support them, because they could start a whole new front in the war. So a bunch of commandos parachute behind enemy lines. They hike up the Carpathian Mountains to this castle at the top of a mountain, and there they find the Nazis were not killed by partisan forces. They were killed by Dracula. And worse still, the German army has discovered the presence of this commando team, and now they're surrounding the castle, so these guys are trapped in a castle with Dracula. And I thought, that's a movie I would absolutely go to see. I don't even like horror movies that much, but I would see this movie. And so I wrote it with that excitement of this particular thing that excited me. I sold it or optioned it to a fairly major Hollywood producer, but he said to me, I love this story, but I can't get it made as a period piece. Is there any way you can make it a modern day story? Can you make it contemporary? And my first instinct was, no, I can't. But then I looked back at my thing that excited me, and I thought, yeah, you know, I can change the political dynamics so it's a Russian-backed paramilitary force in the mountains of Serbia that has surrounded them, and get basically the same dynamics that got me excited in the first place. And so I did. Now, the movie didn't get made, obviously, but I got paid, and it got farther, closer to getting made than it would have if I just said no. The reason, again, was because the thing that excited me could withstand that note. If it would have been something that would have extinguished the note, extinguished the spark, the then I would not have taken the note. Okay, so you've got your you've got your thing, their spark, the thing that excites you. What do you do next? What's next is beats. And what do I mean by a beat? Because the word beat obviously has a lot of different meanings, including punching somebody to a bloody pulp, which is not the next step in screenwriting, although sometimes one wishes it were. No, the word beat also can mean to an actor a short pause like this. That was a beat. That's not what we mean either. To a screenwriter, a beat is a thing that happens in the story, something that happens. If I were telling you the story, any story verbally, every time I got to, and then, those would be beats, story beats. So you want to, the next step in your process is thinking up story beats. This is where most screenwriting books and most screenwriting formulas go awry. Remember, the people who are writing those things don't make a living selling scripts. They make a living selling screenwriting books. So it's in their best interest to get you to use their magic formula as quickly as possible. But that's the wrong impulse. Remember, that's starting with the analytical part of the brain, the left part of the brain, instead of starting with the right part of the brain, the emotional part of the brain. First, you've got to think up all this cool stuff. You've got to daydream. You've got to free associate. You've got to just think up all kinds of stuff. You can't structure a story until you have the material with which to structure it. You don't even know what the story is yet. It's like trying to shape a sculpture out of clay when you don't have any clay. So you're going to dream up all this cool stuff, anything. Got an idea for a scene? Write it down. So this is not like the moment where I told you don't write it down. This, you are going to write down everything. You don't have to write very much because nobody's going to read it except you, just enough to so you remember what that cool idea was. If it's a scene, write it down. This would make a great character. It'd be an interesting supporting character. Write it down. Here's a snippet of dialogue. Write it down. Here's a great shot. Write it down. Write down everything. You may wind up with 2 pages of material in little beat form, or you may have 30 or 50. It doesn't matter. It's just for you. Nobody's going to read it but you. You're accumulating the exciting, cool stuff from which you will structure a movie. Here is something that the Coen brothers said in response in an interview. These are potentially the two best screenwriters of their generation. And the interviewer said, how do you choose what your next story is going to be? And they said, choosing is the wrong word, because when you don't have alternatives that you choose among, you brew something out of some vapor. You distill something by talking about a character or a plot situation or whatever. It's hard to describe. It's more the case that one of us may say something like, supposing John Malkovich is a signals analyst for the CIA and he gets fired for being an alcoholic. That's the beginning of a story. Then where does that go? That's how you think about it. And where does that idea come from? From thinking about John Malkovich drinking or walking around or stumbling around, I don't know, or not, or some other character doing some nonsense. We thought John Turturro and John Goodman are together in a hotel room. It seemed funny and intriguing somehow, so it became Barton Fink. It developed into that as we tried to figure out where that situation would lead. And that's what you're doing. You have an idea, you're going to start trying to figure out where that could lead. It could go this way, it could go that way. This seems interesting, that seems less interesting. When you do that, when you start formulating all this stuff, these beats, and you're writing them down, this is what it often feels like, is what it feels like to me. It's like if you remember in science class looking at an image through a microscope of unicellular animals, little paramecia or amoebas or whatever the heck they are, wiggling around, right? And what happens with unicellular animals is they get eaten unless they start to pair up with other one-celled animals and form multicellular animals so that they can better eat other creatures or keep from getting eaten. And so that's what's happening. Your beats, the beats that you're writing down, are like these little creatures wiggling around, and some of them are going to start to link up. They're going to start to connect. That would be cool, and you know, and that would be cool here, and then that thing I thought of over here, that would fit right here, and it starts to form a multicellular organism. It starts to become a living creature, and the thing that connects them very often, this is a trick somebody mentioned that's a good one, is the words but and so, but not the word and. So if there are story beats you've thought of and they start to connect with so, this happens, so this happens, so this happens. That's called what Aristotle called causality. One scene drives into the next scene logically. Or if they connect with the word but, it's still causality. It's just a plot twist. This happens, but this happens. So and but are great connective tissue. The word and, not so much, because the word and could be anything. It may be connected or it may not be connected. But you start to feel it connect up and start to form a through line of a story, a shape of something that feels like a story, something that feels like an organism, right? And that becomes what I call the spine of the story. Okay, I use the term spine. I sort of borrowed it from William Goldman. Some people use the word premise or log line. I don't like them because they suggest a plot synopsis, like something you might see, on a channel guide. That's not what we're talking about here. The spine of the story is actually this. It is the central conflict. The central conflict, the conflict that must be resolved before this story is over. And once it is resolved, the story is over. And when you come up with your spine, you're going to write it down. And you're going to write it on a post-it and stick it to your computer, because it's precious. It's absolutely required. It's essential. You need to know it. But you can also change it. If you find out that the spine you thought was the correct one isn't quite right, you can always adjust it. And it needs to be in one sentence. Now, that sounds impossible, but that's what it must be. The central conflict of the story should be able to be told in one sentence. poor little orphan girl desperately wants to go to the ball and meet the prince, but she better get back by midnight because that's when her magic carriage and gown will disappear. That's the spine of Cinderella. In fact, that's not a bad way to think about your spine if you want a protagonist with a goal and a conflict. Lawrence of Arabia is one of the greatest movies ever made. In fact, here, look, wait. There, Lawrence of Arabia. One of the greatest movies ever made. It's 4 hours long. 4 hours long. Here's the spine. A young British officer in World War I goes to Arabia and tries to become a god. That's it. That's the spine. That's the story. Every shot, every scene, every image, every line of dialogue is telling that story in those 4 hours. May not be always directly telling it. It may be tangential, but it's moving that central conflict forward. It's addressing that central conflict. If it seems impossible to boil your story down to one sentence, I mean, there's all these different threads and all this stuff going on. Consider this. In 1948, Laurence Olivier directed and starred in a film version of Hamlet. And how he chose to start the movie was you see the castle Elsinore at night. You see a tableau of characters doing what we later will discover is carrying the body of Hamlet away. And over this image, he shot this.
This is the tragedy of a man who could not make up his mind.
Okay, that's probably not exactly the spine of Hamlet. The spine of Hamlet is probably closer to a young prince vows to exact revenge for the murder of his father, but he can't make himself stop thinking long enough to take action. Nonetheless, if Olivier could boil it down to that one sentence, you can do that with your story. Hamlet's probably the most complex piece of dramatic writing in the English language, so I think you can probably do it. And if you can't do it, if you cannot find a way to boil your story down to its one sentence central conflict, then stop, because you are doomed to go down a myriad of roads, writing yourself into corner after corner after corner, draft after draft after draft, until finally, if you hang in there long enough, maybe you'll have whittled it down to what it should have been from the beginning, if you'd simply found the central conflict, the spine of the story, right from the start. And here's why, because the spine of the story is going to tell you what goes in and what goes out. Remember all those beats you thought of? All those clever things, all those wonderful scenes and bits and moments. How do you know what goes in and what goes out unless you have a central conflict to tell you, make that distinction for you? Here's a way of thinking of it. You remember how when you're a kid in grade school, sometimes you'd make a picture with a piece of poster board and some Elmer's glue there. And some glitter like that, right? So let's think of it this way. This is the visual aid portion of this particular video series. Let's say the Elmer's glue is the spine. Okay. And the glitter, all those little bits of glitter, right? Every one of those are story beats, things you thought up. What goes in, what goes out. The spine of the story, the central conflict, will tell you that. So it's as if you dumped them, all these bits of glitter, onto this glue picture you drew. What sticks is part of the story. What does not stick, no matter how clever it is, does not belong in your story, and then you dump it off, and there you go. And who wouldn't want to watch that movie? Okay, so you got your spine, you think it's pretty good, great. Next thing is test it. You want to beat on it, you want to pound on it to make sure it's solid, because that's spine is like the foundation of the story. And if the foundation's weak, it doesn't matter how pretty the house is, it's going to come tumbling down. So you test it. And I test it by asking three questions. One, who cares? Two, what for? Three, so what? Who cares? Who in this story cares about something? Who in the story cares the most about something? Because that's probably going to be your protagonist. That may seem obvious, but it's astounding how often people choose the wrong protagonist. Sometimes they do it in detective movies or detective stories a lot because they just assume the detective is the protagonist, but the detective doesn't really care much about anything in the story, and therefore the story tends to run out of steam. But it also happens in other kind of movies. A few years ago, there's a movie called Bad Teacher, a comedy that starred Cameron Diaz. They obviously sold it on the title, Bad Teacher, isn't it funny? She's the world's worst teacher. And Cameron Diaz was a star at the time, and so, you know, she was obviously going to be the protagonist. The only problem was she was a bad teacher because she didn't care about teaching. She didn't care about anything. And so after a while, the story started to peter out, and what the writers instinctively had to do was shift their protagonist to the antagonist, who was a good teacher who really wanted to do well, but constantly was getting thwarted and frustrated by this bad teacher. And so we naturally, instinctively invested our emotions in that character. She accidentally became the protagonist of the movie, at least for a good long chunk of it, so that they could get to the end of it. Another movie that people still remember fondly is Almost Famous, Cameron Crowe movie. And Cameron Crowe, the writer-director, in his teenage years had been, through a quirk of fate, had become a rock journalist for Rolling Stone. And so he wrote an autobiographical story about that. The problem was his plight wasn't all that interesting. He's a high school kid who has the luckiest job in the world. I guess he cared about his job, but so what? It wasn't that big a deal. On the other hand, there was a character, supposed to be a supporting character, played by Kate Hudson, as a groupie who was going through all kinds of turmoil, internal turmoil, because she was a groupie with this rock band and was discovering that she was sort of outgrowing her need for it, and what does she do with her life, and so on. It was a much more interesting and compelling character because she cared more about her life and where she was in life, and she became the accidental protagonist, and the poster for the movie, in fact, featured her, not the protagonist. So who cares? Second, what for? What do they care about? Is it deep? Is it powerful? Is it emotional? Years ago, there was a movie called Charlie Wilson's War. It starred Tom Hanks at the peak of his stardom. It was written by Aaron Sorkin, no less. It was directed by Mike Nichols, who was a great director. And it was not a particularly big hit. In fact, I don't even know if it made back its money. It's kind of a flop, or at least a semi-flop. And one of the reasons was the main character played by Tom Hanks was a congressman who was trying to get aid to the Mujahideen, the Afghan forces who were fighting the Russians at the time. It was set in the 1980s, I guess. And the problem was, why did this character... What did he care about? He cared about it because he watched a news report about it on 60 Minutes, and that was his big motivation. Well, really? That's it? We're supposed to invest 2 hours in his emotional journey because he saw a news report that he cared about? It didn't hold up. The movie sort of petered out and sputtered to an ending. And the final question is, so what? So what would happen if the protagonist doesn't get what he or she wants? It doesn't have to be life or death stakes. If it's a Mission Impossible movie, obviously it's going to be life or death stakes. But it has to be important. It has to be powerful. If it's a comedy or a romantic comedy or a drama, it may not be someone's going to die, but it certainly has to be as powerful as someone's life is going to be ruined. It's going to be changed in a negative way. They're going to lose a part of their soul. It has to be something worthy of our time, worthy of spending an hour and a half to 2 hours. If you're doing a television show, let's say a half-hour comedy, it's probably not, almost never going to be life or death stakes, but you still need to make those stakes as powerful and as meaningful as you possibly can. That character, if they don't get what they want, is going to be potentially hurt in a serious way emotionally. I recently had an experience working on a kids show at Disney. And the storyline for this little 11-minute show for little kids involved the jeopardy of the main character, the protagonist, losing their favorite toy, right? Now, to an adult, that seems silly, but to a kid, if you're 4, 5, 6 years old, losing your favorite toy is life or death stakes. It's huge. And we had this very discussion in the writer's room and came to the conclusion, yeah, that's a powerful enough so what, that the character would be devastated if they can't find their favorite toy. And that was enough to hold up an 11-minute story for kids. We'll come back to the spine and how to use it in a bit. But next up, remember I promised you the 3 most important words in storytelling, and that's coming up next.